Hello everyone, and thanks for joining me for this new video. In today's video, we will build together this simple component. And one of the interesting elements of this component is this star icon that I used as a watermark. And maybe you already experienced that when you place an element and you set a negative Zend index to this element, it disappears from your screen. So while building this component, we will see together why this happens and what we can do to fix it. And to create it, we will work in bricks, but we could do exactly the same thing in oxygen. So I will start by creating a wrapper for my element by adding a section. Let's highlight my cursor. It's better for you. Pick the section and I will give it a full height that gives a 100 VH height. And I want my section container to be centered in my section. So I will still on my section add the class SuperCenter. I want my container to be visible. I will give it a class of card 1, 2. It will be a card 2. And I also will give it a width of 65 rem. So if you remember, in my container, we have two elements, a photo on the left and an icon and text on the right. To achieve this, our container will be a grid. So on the container, let's add a grid, and I will have two columns on my grid, but they won't be of equal width. So I will add a grid 3-2. It's not visible yet, but 3-2 means that out of all the available width, the left part will take 3 fractions and the right part will take 2 fractions. I will also add some padding. Let's go for a padding 4. And now I will add my image. Here it is. And to add the image, let's use OxyProps random image menu that uses the Lorem Picsum API. So in my image element content tab, I will come to the external URL field, right click. This opens the specific Lorem Picsum context menu, and I will choose a square image, and you have various size you can pick from. So I will take the 768 by 768. And as you noticed, the API returns random images. So each time you request an image, it will return a random one. Now that I have my image, I would like it to have rounded corners to match my container. With the image selected, I will call the class radius, and bricks suggests all the radius options, and I will choose the radius 2, which is a small radius that will match my card. And as you notice, as I added the class, bricks did rebuild my canvas, and therefore did generate new request to the Picsum API, which returned new random image. If you use it for client mockups, for example, this could be confusing to have different images each time you reload the page. So a way to get a random image once, but then always have the same image, is to add what they call a seed to the URL. So I will add a seed, and I will make anything as my seed can be a random string of text. But from now, we will give it a try. But a good sign is the fact that we have the same image in my preview here and in my canvas. Let's save, refresh. And we get the same image again. In case you don't like it, just change your random string of text to anything else, and this will generate a new image. Let's keep this one. And then in my grid, I will add in my container, in my grid, I will add a div. I want my div height to match the image height. So at my container level, that's the grid level, I will add the class stretch, just stretch this one. And as you notice, as I hover the class, my div takes all the available height, like that. Now I want some space here between my image and my div, so I will add a gap to my container, like this. and I have a gap matching my padding. That's perfect. So now let's add some content to our div. Remember, I want an icon, a heading, a text, and then I want a button at the bottom. But I don't want a completely even spacing between my elements. I want a kind of group with my icon, heading, and text at the top, and I want my button at the bottom. So I will create another container. I will use a block. So I select the block. So now I can add an icon, a heading, and the text. Back to my div level, I will add another text. Of course, we want some spacing. So let's take care of the upper part. For now, I will pick the block. By default, bricks apply a display flex to the block element. So we should only have to add a gap. This should work, it works, to add vertical spacing. My div, and it's a good thing, has no specific styling from bricks, so I need to make it a flex column, and then I don't want to add a gap, but I want my block part to be on top and my button to be at the bottom. And for this, flexbox give us the space between value that we will apply to the main axis. As I did define a flex column, the main axis is vertical. So on my main axis, I will choose space between, and you can see live what happens. It will push the two elements to the flex start, the top, and to the flex end, the bottom, and place all the available space between the elements. So I'll validate. Perfect. Let's now take care of my icon. I will change this icon to this spray. Okay, and I will change the color to my accent color. I want it to be bigger, so let's try maybe 20 rem. Oh, that's a lot. 10 rem, why not? My heading will be H2. And again, if I'm building a mockup for my client, I can use placeholder text. For this, I will use the OxyProps context menu. Right click in my content, and for my heading, I want maybe 3 words. So I get 3 words. I will do the same for my text. I want 1 paragraph of text. And for my button, I want a single word. That's okay. Now let's take care of our button. I will use the btn class that will style my button. The o-btn class is the basis class. If you want to style a button using the framework predefined style, of course you can create your own custom button. But if you want to use the framework button classes, you always have to add the o-btn, and then you can add additional classes. For example, I want this button to match the brand color I defined for the site, so I will add a btn brand, and I have 2 options, a plain version and a gradient version. I will use the gradient version. That's perfect. I will define a link just to have a button behavior and therefore a pointer cursor on my button. It's not visible yet, but it will be visible on the front end. And I want to add a bigger font size to my button. So let's go to style, typography, unselect the class, and I will, yes, this one, a font size fluid 2, will be perfect for my button. Maybe you noticed that this button took the full width. That's the default behavior that bricks gives to the element. But if you want a different behavior, the button having its normal size, the size it would have without bricks giving it 100% width, still on the button, we can go to the layout. You see it's grayed out, but that's bricks default 100%. Let's override this and give it a width of max content. Max content meaning that the button will adjust to the maximum width of its content, so the length of the word. And now I would like my button to be on the right side, so I will give it a left margin of auto. Perfect. Let's save. And now I want to create this watermark with a star icon. So let's go to my card container and I will add a new icon. Here it is. We have a star. And in order for my star to appear where I want on my card, I will position it absolutely. But to position something absolutely, it needs to know what will be the reference to this positioning. And an element that you position absolutely will always take as a reference the closest parent having a position relative. So if I want to position it absolutely relative to my div, I need to make sure that my div has a position relative. So let's add the class relative to my div. And now I can pick my icon and give it a class of absolute. And now it is absolutely positioned relative to my div. You notice that Bricks did notice that we positioned it absolutely, so it's grayed out, but it says absolute position. I want it to be minus 20% from the top, minus 20% from the right. But then I want to give it a size of 40 rem, perfect, and a color of my brand color with an opacity of 10%. I will also give it a transform, rotate, and I will give it a rotate Z. It's along the Z axis. That's the rotation you would expect when you rotate something on your 2D screen. And I will give it an angle of 30 degrees. Okay, maybe I will modify a little my positioning like that. Okay, and now maybe this is not visible because of the opacity I set, but our star is printed over our text. Maybe we will have a better look. I don't know if you can see on the video, but I can see my star over my text, and I don't want this. I want my text to be nice. So what I want to do is send my star to the back. For this, we use a Z index. So just make sure that I am selecting the star. Currently, I'm on the section. So grab the icon, layout, Z index. I right click and I give it a layer of -1, and then my star disappears. What? Okay, that's because my star went far behind my div, behind my container, behind my body. It's completely at the back of all the elements on my page. So of course it's not visible. But what I want is my star to be behind these elements. So I want it to be a -1 Z index, a -1 layer relative to my div. A bit in the same manner that I absolutely positioned it relative to the div. I would like to -1 Z index it relative to the div and the elements inside my div, but not relative to all elements on my page. So to achieve that, we need to create a new stacking context. A new stacking context means that at my div element, I create this new stacking context, and within this stacking context, any Z index I will assign will remain relative to this stacking context. And to achieve this, we will just use a simple class from the framework, and this class is called isolate. And we must make sure we apply it to the element where we want to create this new stacking context. In our case, it will be the div, this one. So at this level, I will add the class isolate. And as soon as I pick the class, you see that the star is reappearing. The star still has a minus one Z index, but now we have created a new stacking context. And then this minus one is relative to this new context. To show you better, I will give it back a brown color with no transparency. So you can see that the star is behind all the elements in my div. I will even enlarge it and change its positioning. And what you can see is that my star that has a minus one Z index is behind all the elements in my div, but is in front of my image and in front of the container. So let's give it back its opacity of 10%. Perfect. And now the last thing we want to do is that we don't want it to expand that much. Let's get back to a more reasonable size. Perfect. And what I want is to cut everything that extends over my container element. So for this, I need to go at my container element level and I will add an overflow hidden. And this is given by a class. Just have to type hidden. And you see that several classes are suggested because in CSS, you can define an overflow for the top bottom axis and for the left right axis. But we want it defined for all axes. So it's simply the overflow hidden class that we want to pick. Okay, I still find my icon a bit big at 60 rem. So let's get back to 40 rem and give it its positioning back. Here we are. And now our component is finished. We can have a look at the front end. And here is our finished component with our button, our placeholder image that we did set to a fixed random image by placing a seed, and our star watermark that is placed behind any element in our new stacking context, but in front of other elements in the DOM. If you liked the video, of course, give it a like, press the like button, subscribe to the channel if you haven't yet for other videos like this one. Tell me in the comments if you did know about the stacking context and the ways you plan to use it. I wish you good website builds and I'll see you in the next video.